Great. Well, good afternoon and welcome to Local Stories from Amersham Museum. This is the first of a series of programmes that we're doing, and the aim is for us to share with you over the next 45 minutes the stories of local people and local places from the past. This first session, we're going to look at the Weller family, our local brewers, but we're going to look at a couple of other Wellers as well. And the aim of the programme really is to do a mixture of things. So we're hoping that each one will feature a short talk that will look about at a particular person or place. And it might, where possible, look at new research or perhaps things that we haven't shared before. We're also hoping always to have a 5-minute focus, which is a focus on a particular object, artefact, map or document in the collection. And then each session will finish with something interactive. So today, because we're looking at brewing, we're going to have a pub quiz at the end using the polling function on Zoom. So we're hoping that that's going to work out well. But we've had a few people that we know wanted to join us this afternoon or would in future, but they're not able to. So the aim is to record it, edit it, and then put it on our website. Yes, I think that's all I wanted to say about that. So we're going to start this afternoon's session with a talk from Alison Bailey, who is a trustee and a volunteer at the museum and a local historian, and Peter Burrows, who's also a volunteer at the museum. He does a lot around our Tudor programme, leading walks and helping with interpretation, but he's also a duty manager in the museum, and over lockdown, he's done some research about the Wellers. So I'm going to hand over to Alison, who's going to start off.
Hi, everyone. So the first of our local stories that we bring you today are stories of the Weller family, as Emily said. And many of you will be familiar with the story of the brewery and its importance to our town. Indeed, many former brewing buildings like the Maltings and this one, now called Badminton Court, still exist. But place names such as Weller Close and Plantation Road at Amersham Common are also part of the Weller legacy and a reminder of our past. Over 170 years of local history came to an end in 1945 when this lady on the left, Gladys Fawcett, the eldest child of George and Blanche Weller, put her family estate, the plantation, up for auction. On the right is an extract from the museum sale brochure. And you can see from this what a substantial property it was, sort of some 60 acres, glass houses, walled garden, etc. Well, Gladys was born in the house in 1872, and she moved back with her husband after her widowed father's death in 1929. She was widowed herself before World War II, and then stayed on at the house, but running such a large estate on her own must have been a challenge. And when the war was over, Gladys sold up. Amersham Council bought the estate for much needed social housing, and several roads were built on the land in the late 40s and early 50s. And these new roads start up around Weller Close up here and come right down to Rahms Road at the bottom here. And as you can see on the right, there's an early council house in Weller Close. That photo we know was taken around 1950. And Plantation itself was divided into 9 flats and renamed Park Place. And this survived until 1976, when Amersham Council demolished it and built around 130 flats on the site, just around here. However, of course, the auction that really changed the history of Amersham had taken place some years earlier in 1929. And this was when Gladys's brother, Gerard, against his father's wishes, sold the company to Benskins of Watford. The Amersham site closed soon after the sale, as the new owners decided not to use it as a bottling plant. And this meant loss of all jobs. And as well as was the largest employer in the town, this was a bitter blow and caused much hardship. If you like, it was Amersham's own Wall Street crash. But let us start at the beginning. In the early 1770s, when a 44-year-old brewer and maltster from High Wycombe, William Weller, moved to Amersham. The 1770s were turbulent years. George III was on the throne, James Cook was exploring the Pacific Ocean and mapping Australasia, and America was about to declare its independence. Amersham was a small rural town, but it was relatively prosperous. Thanks to the coaches travelling from London to Birmingham and Reading to Hatfield, which stopped in the town. It had a weekly market and a grand market hall. The current Lord of the Manor, William Drake, had just completed this fashionable new house at Chardelot's using his wife's wealth, which was created by the South Sea Company. The town itself contained fine coaching inns and gentlemen's houses, which were mostly owned by brewers, as there is a long history of brewing in Amersham and money in beer. William Weller, here on the left, bought part of the Church Street Brewery. He moved to the town with his wife, Anne, and six children, with several more born here. William was almost exactly the same age as the local squire, William Drake, on the right, who, as well as the new manor house, owned most of the land and property in the town. He was also the largest employer by far. His brother John was the rector, and William was one of the town's two MPs. His son was the other one, so as you can see, the Drakes had total control of the town. But our William, William Weller, had profitable investments in High Wycombe to support the investment in Amersham, and by the time of his death in 1802, he'd built the brewery into a substantial business for three of his sons to inherit. At which point, I will hand over to Peter to tell you about the next generation.
Well, on the north side of St Mary's Church, near the west door, is the Weller family memorial plot. Nine graves, naming in all 21 people. Everyone a Weller, except one, George Channer. George Channer of Black River, Jamaica. He was the husband of one of the Weller girls, and I'll come back to him later. But it does give a clue that the Weller story is not just one of a simple brewing family. The founder of the dynasty, William Weller, had at least six sons and four daughters, and although one son died in infancy, three of the sons became brewers like their father, John, William, and Joseph. And it's Joseph I'm going to focus on here. He married Mary Brooks, who was the daughter of a maltster, in Aylesbury, and they married in 1801, and his first two sons, Joseph Brooks Weller and George Weller, were baptised here in Amersham. Now, Joseph suffered from consumption, tuberculosis, and he was advised to move to a warmer coastal climate, and he did so in about 1806 or 1807. We know he was there in 1807 because his first surviving daughter, Mary Brooks Weller, was baptised there. And later another daughter, Anne, and the youngest, but perhaps most daredevil of the sons, Edward. Now, this is still research in progress. There are some loose ends to be cleared up. But in the 1820s, the two older sons, Joseph and George, made separate reconnaissance trips to Australia, and after returning to England, persuaded the whole family to emigrate. Joseph and the youngest son, Edward, went first in 1829, and they were followed a year later by brother George with his new wife, Eliza, his father and his wife, and George's two surviving sisters. So they all emigrated to Australia. His father, having sold his business and property in and around Folkestone for a large sum of money. Part of that money was invested in land in Australia, but part was invested in setting up a shipping and a whaling business in Sydney, and that actually seems to have become quite successful. In 1831, Joseph and Edward set off in the whaler, the Lusiane. It was owned by the Weller Company, they set off for New Zealand to set up a whaling business. And they landed near what later became the city of Dunedin. They landed at a place called Weller's Rock, although the Maoris already had a name for it, which I'm not going to attempt to pronounce. But they, despite some setbacks, they did become successful quite quickly, employing 80 odd people there, not just at Weller's Rock, but on half a dozen other whaling stations. They were farming, they were selling supplies to visiting ships, and so on. And Edward had children with at least two Maori women, and one of his grandsons became a celebrated rugby footballer. Edward also insisted on actually captaining some of the whaling expeditions. And as you can see from the picture, that's a bit of an iffy business. And his brother, George, back in Sydney, was really quite concerned about it. But Edward was a bit determined. When his elder brother, Joseph, died of tuberculosis in New Zealand, Edward had him shipped back to Sydney in a barrel of rum. Now, the whaling business declined somewhat in the late 1830s, and George, back in Sydney, was quite keen to pull out, but Edward was a bit persistent. And it was only after some rather dodgy land deals that Edward finally left New Zealand. He handed over the remainder of the business, which was still quite successful because they were farming and supplying ships and so on, handed over the remaining business to a guy called Charles Schultz. And guess what? Charles Schultz later married his sister, Ann Weller. Now, towards the end of 2020, sea shanties became very popular on TikTok, and in particular one sea shanty known as the Weller Man. And the sea shanty tells the story of whalers waiting for the supply ship, the Weller Man, in other words one of the ships run by the Weller Company of Sydney, to bring them sugar, tea and rum. It also tells the story of the rather obstinate captain who, having harpooned a whale, won't cut the line, despite the whale towing the boat for days on end. Now, surely that captain must be based on the obstinate Edward Weller. Interestingly enough, just a few years later, in 1842, Herman Melville joined that way, that very way that Lucy Ann, that the brothers had gone to New Zealand in. He joined it in the Marquesas Islands, whence it sailed to Tahiti. Now, of course, Melville was the author of Moby Dick, and once tempted to speculate that perhaps Edward Weller was not only the inspiration for the Wellerman sea shanty, but also the inspiration for Captain Ahab.
Once was a ship that put to sea. The name of the ship was a Bully of Tea. The wind blew up her bird up down below my bully boy's bow. Soon may the Wellerman come to bring us sugar and tea and rum. One day when the tonguing is done, we'll take our leave and go. She'd not been 2 weeks from shore when down on her a right whale bore. The captain called all hands and swore he'd take the whale in tow.
Okay, now the mention of sugar and rum brings us to another Weller connection through cousins of the three Australian brothers. Joseph Weller, their father, had left the brewery, you remember, in about 1806, leaving his two brothers, John and William, in charge. William had at least six sons and two daughters. Most of the sons died relatively young, and only the fourth son, another William, went into the brewery. But the oldest son, Henry, who is here, Henry Weller there, and Henry Weller there, the oldest son went to Black River in Jamaica. where he was involved in a partnership, probably accountancy and that sort of work, with George Channer. And although the partnership was later dissolved, Henry took over the whole business. Now, Black River was a slaving port. Henry, as you can see here, had two children with Sarah Smith, who is described as a free mulatto. Free means she's not a slave, and mulatto means that she was a child of one black and one white parent. And Henry actually died in 1815. Now, Henry's brother, younger brother, John Lacey Weller, was also in Black River at the time, and he too had children with local women. There's John Weller there, and John Lacey Weller here. The first two of these children, with Anne Thompson, well, she is described, as you can see here, rather distressingly, actually, as a Negro belonging to Mary Hook. Whereas his next partner, Dorothy Helen Stewart, is described as people of colour. Although John Lacey Weller died in 1823, his descendants, well, at least one of his descendants, received some compensation under the Slavery Abolition Act of 1833 by freeing their slaves. Sophia Weller had three slaves and was awarded £65, 13 shillings and 11 pence. And Sophia must have been a descendant of one or other of these women. Now, I mentioned right at the beginning, George Channer. Now, George Channer, he was in a business partnership with Henry Weller, but seems to have been a rather disreputable character because he left Black River secretly in 1813, has since disappeared, getting off the island. He left various debts behind. Not only was he disreputable from that point of view, but he had earlier returned from Jamaica to Amersham in order to marry Mary Weller, the eldest daughter of William Weller, and therefore she was the sister of Henry and John Lacey. And this despite the fact that George Channer already had a family in Black River. And his family, George Channer had at least nine children with Mary back in England, but in addition, three more with Sarah Delano, who was described on the baptism records as a free mestize. Free, not a slave, and mestize is a term used in Hispanic America for children of mixed European and indigenous descent. Note finally that in all, that the children were described as white by law, and that these children, and indeed all the other children I've shown you today, the fathers were described as reputed fathers. That, in fact, does not mean that the fatherhood was being questioned, but simply that they were born out of wedlock. And at which point, back to boring old Amersham. Alison?
Thanks, Peter. I'm now going to tell you a bit more about the later generations of the Weller family, and particularly the family at the plantation. So George inherited the brewery with two brothers after his father's death in 1859. And this is in fact a portrait of his father, William, on the left. Surprisingly, we don't have a photo or portrait of George. And we're really hoping that one does come up. But this is as close as we can get at the moment. So George was the youngest brother, youngest of three brothers, and had started working in the brewery as soon as he finished school. The Weller children appear to have been educated first at home by tutors, then at school in Amersham, before boarding at Brighton. In 1871, George left his widowed mother, Lydia, and young siblings at Rumsey's, the family home next to the brewery, to marry Blanche Heath Masterman when he was 27 and Blanche was 22. And as you can see from this gorgeous portrait of Blanche on her wedding day, she was quite a catch. She was beautiful and wealthy. Her father was a successful brewer in Wanstead in Essex, and he had recently died, leaving Blanche with a substantial inheritance. She was married from her brother's home at Woolworth Castle in County Durham, where she'd been living in some style with footmen and a butler. So presumably her expectations were set quite high at the start of her marriage. There was evidently a network of brewers with families socialising together. I think Peter mentioned a brewery marriage earlier, but George's mother, Lydia, had been heiress to a brewery in Hemel. So these newlyweds bought a house from Lord Chesham at Amersham Common, and they named it Plantation Cottage. And you can just see the plantation here on the right-hand side. And due to the family's links in the Caribbean, presumably, as explained by Peter, but they dropped the name Cottage as the house was massively extended and upgraded. Now, Amersham Common was still very rural in the 1870s. This map is actually much later. In 1871, scattered across the common, which stretched from Hyde Heath to Little Chalfont, there were only a handful of pubs, labourers' cottages, and a few country estates such as Bendrose Grange and Beale House. The rest of the common was farmland and included Hirons, Quill Hall, Rahn's, and Woodside Farm, shown here, which was owned by the Wellers. However, this was definitely an aspirational move. The house is situated between Chardelot's and Latimer House, the home of Lord Chesham and the Cavendish family, and George Weller wanted to create his own country estate, which is indeed what he did, as these rather grainy photos show you. So this is the exterior of the house, the greatly extended plantation cottage. Then we've got an interior of the dining room. And these are from our sales brochure. I'm afraid they're poor quality, but at least they give you some idea of the property. And this is the parkland, which you can see was very extensive. So the Weller fortune substantially increased in 1887 when George sold 44 acres of the neighbouring farmland to the Metropolitan Railway, capitalising on his family's early investment. George was one of the first of the local businessmen to appreciate the new development opportunities heralded by the arrival of the railway. And in 1893, opposite the new station, he built the Station Hotel, later known as the Iron Horse, which was demolished in 2004. And he also laid out building plots along the new station road where it passed through Woodside farmland. As the family prospered, the number of indoor staff employed at the plantation increased until a footman, a butler's and a lady's maid were also employed, in addition to the normal housemaids, cooks and kitchen maids. There were even more outdoor staff, with a groom, stable boys, a coachman, undercoachman, later a chauffeur, and several full-time gardeners. Now, the Bucks Family History Society recently discovered this wages ledger kept by George Weller, which is a fantastic source for more research, and is now deposited at the Bucks Archives. Sadly, we can't get to those at the moment, but we should be able to shortly. So Gladys was followed by two brothers, Gerard Masterman, who was destined to join his father in the brewery and live at Rumsey's, and Carl and Lacey, who became a civil engineer and inherited the adventurous Weller gene. He worked as a railway surveyor in Borneo, Africa and Brazil. Apparently he was an excellent figure skater and skied into his 80s. And Gladys herself was a serious croquet player and All England club champion at Wimbledon when it was more famous for croquet than tennis. So George's death in 1929 was at the end of his influence on the town, however. In 1930, the Weller Estate was planned by the Metropolitan Railway Company to build new houses on the remaining Woodside farmland. The estate was never completed, but the undeveloped land was bought by the council and used for community buildings and playing fields. Most of the town's recreational space, including Marl Meadow and Old Amersham, and Amersham Cricket Club on Amersham Common, was originally Weller land. As the Weller family founded many of the town's sports clubs, and a keen sportsman himself, George would have been particularly proud of this. And so finally, at the end of the Weller dynasty in Amersham, we can see how things were changed in the town. When Wellers was founded in 1775, the Drake family had all the power and wealth, but by the 1900s, the Wellers are up there with them. The brewery was now the largest employer, and both families were substantial landowners who had profited from the arrival of the railway. Both were respected as local gentry and shared the same lifestyle, their country pursuits and grand houses. This is one of the salons in Chardelot's on the left and the plantation dining room again on the right. So you can see, you know, there's elements of grandeur in both. They both hold summer fetes in their extensive grounds, and their wives have similar roles. They support various charitable causes in the town, give out school prizes and judge roses. Both men participate in local politics as justices of the peace and conservative councillors on the district and country and county councils. And finally, they have both lost their country estates by the end of World War II. Luckily, Chardelot's was saved from demolition in the 1950s, but what a pity that such a fine arts and craft house was lost in 1976 and almost no records remain of it.
If you're familiar with Zoom, you'll know that there's a chat bar at the bottom of your screen, a little chat function. You can press that and write in a question. If you find that difficult, but you would really like to ask a question or make a comment, then please either wave your hand or unmute yourself and ask your question, and we'll do our best to answer you. So has anyone got a question? I've got the chat bar open. There's nothing in there yet, but we'll wait a minute or two if anyone has a question, anything they'd like to ask, Alison or Peter.
I don't see anyone waving. I'll scan through the screens. Mind you, a lot of people haven't got their picture up. It'd be difficult to see them.
As I say, if you want to unmute yourself and just ask a question, you're very welcome to, if there's anything you'd like to find out.
Hi, this is Karen here. I don't know why I haven't got my picture up. I've only just been on Zoom and it was fine before.
That's okay. Karen, did you want to ask a question?
I thought it was really interesting, actually. I've often wondered about the Weller family. It's actually quite nice, interesting. I haven't got anything offhand, but no.
I mean, it's a big family, so we're only telling you obviously a little bit and an insight, and look particularly at some of the research that we've been doing, or and the Wellerman story in the news, which I'm sure some of you will have seen. We thought that was a good opportunity to tell you a little bit more about what went behind it. There's a question from Sheila, which says, are the Wellers living in Amersham now?
I think the answer is no, as far as we, unless someone in this audience wants to say otherwise. I think we found some in Surrey and places like that, didn't we, Alison? But I think they're probably the closest.
We've got another question, which is, which ales did they brew? I think that is a question we'd all like to answer. Alison, do you want to say anything about that?
The only one I'm very familiar with is the Weller's Entire, which I understand was like a Guinness. And I think we'd love to find the recipe and recreate it for the town. Rebellion Brewery in Marlow have got the original Marlow Brewery recipe, and that's what they use. And I think it'd be great if it could be found. I have spotted that we've got Malcolm Weller in the crowd. I don't know if that's Malcolm Weller from, who is one of the most local Wellers that we know. Very much Malcolm, if that's you on the screen as well, for joining us.
It is,
he's got his hand up, so I don't know. Do you want to say anything, Malcolm?
Am I unmuted?
Yes. You are unmuted, yep.
Yes, there are quite a number of Wellers in the audience at the moment, and almost direct descendants of William Weller of 1727, who founded the brewery. but we did break off a little after that. I have to admit my memory of the family tree is, it keeps waning, but we're a descendant of the butcher, Thomas Weller, the butcher.
That was the son who didn't actually go into the brewery, wasn't it? I think it was the second son.
Yes.
Yeah.
But also there's a lot of this information that my aunt, who should be in the audience as well, that's Barbara Weller, she collected a lot of this information and I put it onto a family tree website, which I think, Peter, you have been looking at.
I have been looking at, and our listener, I think.
Yes, me too. It's a really useful source. Thank you very much, Barbara and Malcolm. It's our main source, really. There's also quite a lot of information at the Otago University in New Zealand, who I've contacted this week as well about using some of their photos, but there's some fantastic stuff on there. I found a really good PhD dissertation about the Wellers and Whaling. So if anyone wants to find out more, there's quite a lot of stuff out there on the internet. We are going to publish an article on a new article shortly on our website, which will have lots of these links and the sources, so you will be able to find them by those sources as well.
Actually, I'm going to ask a question because I thought prior to the brewing business with Weller, do you know where they came from originally? Was that mentioned earlier?
Well, I think. William Weller the First, so to speak, moved to High Wycombe from somewhere in Oxford.
When was that?
Well, William Weller was born in 1727. So I'm not quite sure when he moved to High Wycombe, or at least when his parents presumably moved to High Wycombe. But I think the family tree that Malcolm was talking about does go quite a long way back further than that.
Interesting to know why they came to High Wycombe, for instance.
Yeah. Well, it's a big town, isn't it? It's on the main road. It's the A40, isn't it? Well, it wasn't called the A40 in those days, but it was the main road to Oxford and the West.
Mm. I can see Sue Weller, Sue X Weller, has got a hand up.
I just wanted to say thank you very much for doing this. There are hundreds and hundreds of Wellers all around the world. We actually lived in Great Missenden in the 1970s and used to visit Amersham quite a lot. And so I'd been imbibed with Weller history. My grandfather was part of the Weller family, but didn't wasn't included in the brewery itself. But the story always was that in the middle of the 19th century, the Wellers had so many children, and they decided to educate them all, the girls as well as the boys, and that's how they lost all their money, at least the ones who didn't go into the brewery. But I was always told that the original William Weller came from Newington, which I think is in Oxfordshire, and they were all maltsters to begin with, and so they were involved in the farming, and so it was natural to move to Amersham, of course, where there was water around the original brewery, so there, it was natural for them to move across there and the Chilterns. Thank you very much anyway for doing it all.
Thank you, Sue. That sort of fits with what I knew as well. And they all seem to have very large families. And we found lots of the younger brothers seem to become clergymen. So we've got a long line of Weller clergymen as well as adventurers and whalers and what have you.
I think Weller wasn't properly married unless they were married by one of the family, actually.
One of the Wellers, in fact, my relation, married the daughter of the vicar of Chesham. And there was an enormous wedding there between Chesham and Amersham. They got married, I think, in Chesham or in Amersham now. And as you're right, the hundreds and hundreds of Wellers, and a lot of them were clergymen. One of them became Bishop of the Falklands. Became a Bishop of the Falklands. So
your relative then was the Edward Weller, George's older brother. And you're right, him and his wife, I think it was Edith, who was the rector's daughter, had a huge family. And she was widowed very young. Edward died young, leaving her with all these children to educate. And she sold up her share of the brewery to George and moved to Brighton, where the children seemed to be educated. And then the families were in Brighton for a while.
She was actually my great-great-grandmother. So Edward, she married Edward. So, And in fact, my daughter, who was in New Zealand 2 years ago, visited the Weller Rock and had a photograph of herself taken by the Weller Rock. So, thank you.
Thank you. This is exactly what we hoped would happen, really, is that people would listen and share their stories. So, hopefully this is the beginning of a conversation. So if there's things that you'd like to share with the museum, or there's the excellent website as well, the Weller website, we'd be really delighted to, hear from you outside of today as well. We're going to move on now to what I've called, our 5 minute focus. And so today, the 5 minute focus is, not surprisingly, has a Weller theme. Right, there we are. Can everybody see that? So I'm going to tell you a little bit over the next 5 minutes, so it's going to be quite quick, about another George Weller, but this time not a brewer. Although based on the discussion that we've just had, I'm sure he is related to someone in the brewing family going way back. But the lovely thing about this story is we're trying to use this section to focus on something in the collection that's new or that you perhaps might not have seen before. And this is, today we're looking at a series of photographs and reminiscences which have been sent to me from Australia. So we're carrying on that link a little bit with a couple that have Amersham links, and the wife of that couple, the donor, this is her parents in this photograph. So on the left we have Ernest Weller, who was known as George because his father was also called Ernest. And that's his wife there, Evelyn May Fountain. So, and it's the parents of the lady that I've been corresponding with. Evelyn was born in 1910, and her husband, Ernest, known as George, was born in 1909. So this is a photograph that features Ernest, who I'll call from George from now on, because that's how he's known. That's him on the far left there. And in this photograph, which is much later in the 1930s, he's featured here with his, a couple of his siblings and some of his friends. And for those of you who are less familiar with Amersham, in the background of that photograph, that's the workhouse, which later became Amersham Hospital and is now flats, which is on Wealden Street in Amersham. So George Weller was the son of Mary Ann Smith, who was from High Wycombe, and the aforementioned Ernest Senior, who was from Loudwater, and born in 1877. And we know from the 1911 census that in the couple in 1911 had six children and were living in Bury End in Amersham. This is another one of all of these, bar one, of photographs which I've been sent from the donor in Australia. This is another photograph here of George. What she also sent along with the photographs were some reminiscences written by George. They're particularly touching because they were written by him during World War II, whilst he was serving as a driver for the Royal Engineers. So he was away from home trying to put down the memories of his life to date. And in that, he talks about his early childhood. He talks about his experiences of the Spanish flu. And then he goes on to talk about his first job. I'm going to read you a little bit of what he's written. As the eldest son, I was the first to start work, and my first job was a paper round early morning, then a grocer's assistant for the rest of the day for the sum of 10 shillings a week. This is probably about 1925, I think. Working some evenings as late as 10 p.m. after walking 3 miles with a heavy basket of groceries to deliver and 2 gallons of paraffin in my other hand, both of which became very heavy before the end of 3 miles. Now, not surprisingly, having to walk 3 miles with that paraffin and all the groceries, George only lasted in that job for about a year. And after that, he found himself at the plantation estate, where he got himself a job working as a learner gardener for his namesake, George Weller. He seems to have been very happy there because he worked there for 6 years. And it was also there that he met his wife, Evelyn. I'm going to read to you now a little bit about some of his reminiscences of working there as a gardener. By the end of my first year, I found a better job as a learner gardener on the estate of England's largest privately owned brewery for a millionaire whose name was the same as my own, George Weller. I spent 6 happy years there where I made several good friends, including the cook and Mr. Jack Lane, who imparted to me a great deal of his vast store of knowledge and experience in indoor and outdoor gardening. The other boy, Joe Hans, and myself had some grand larks, which caused Tom Wall, the groom, to chase us into the orchard with his coach whip. It sounds like he really enjoyed his time there, but notwithstanding the coach whip. The other great thing about them sending me these photographs and the reminiscences has it's given me an opportunity to look back and check what we had in the collection. And this was a photograph, the only photograph that I thought we had of the plantation estate. And it's then that I went back and looked at the sale catalogue and realised that we had the pictures of the house that Alison showed you. But by sending this photograph to the couple in Australia, they were able to identify that this was their George on the left. So they were really delighted to see the picture. And this is a photograph of George working with his fellow gardeners, cutting the lawn, mowing the lawn at the plantation. This is another photograph that they sent, and this we think is them digging the lily pond on the estate, which looks like lots of hard work. The other thing that he notes, he does give a little bit in what he's written down about the scale of the estate, which was detailed in that sale catalogue, but I suppose he adds a little bit more to it. So one of the things he talks about are the 8 glasshouses on the plantation, and that one of his jobs was to go around and light the fires for them. And he said that's effectively how he wooed Evelyn, that she would only go for a short walk with him to start with, but by the end he got her to go around and help him light the fires for the glasshouses. One of the loveliest stories, which is where I really want to finish, that they then recounted to us was George meeting George. So one day, apparently, George, let's call him George Weller the Brewer, was walking around his estate and having a look at the garden, and he comes across George the Gardener. He asks George the Gardener his name, to which he honestly replies, George Weller. George Weller the Brewer was so cross that he thought he was being impertinent that he was sacked on the spot. It seems that George was a good employer and all was explained, and he did get his job back, hence the fact that he was able to work there for 6 years. And I suppose the fact that a sort of testimony really to George the Brewer as a good employer was on his death, George the Gardener notes that every member of staff on the estate was given 6 months' wages. This is the photo I showed you at the beginning. So this is him in a later job after he left the plantation, a photo of him with Evelyn. And what's been great about the things that they've sent is it's added this detail and colour. So some of the names he's mentioned, particularly now we've got this wages book, we'll be able to cross-reference them. We'll be able to do a little bit more research about some of the staff that worked on the estate and hopefully build a richer picture of what it was like to be there. Alongside George's memories of growing up in the town, we've also got Evelyn's. And so she, because she was born in Amersham, we've got the stories of her going to St. George's Infant School, of growing up locally, of their experience of rationing. So they're two lovely stories, and it's been so great to have been sent them from far away and for us to add them to our collection. I don't know if anyone's got any comments or questions they want to ask about this George, or whether they know if there's any connections. But if you do, if you want to put them into the chat bar now. Oh, Malcolm, that's really helpful. I noticed that you've added in the details of the website. I was going to mention those at the end. So that's great.
And if anyone wants to submit any information, I know Sue was mentioning some things that might be useful to be added, then please contact me, and I've got my email address down there as well.
Brilliant, thank you. Yeah, so if anyone wants to see that, if you click on the chat where it says chat on Zoom, you'll be able to see that in the chat bar.
I see somebody has asked a question. Sheila Borwick says it's pretty enterprising to go to Australia and then New Zealand. Would they have had seamanship training? The answer is I don't know, but we do know, I think, Alison, don't we, that Joseph, the father, was in the had military training in the Buckinghamshire regiments.
Yeah, he was in the Bucks Yeomanry, that's right, Lieutenant Colonel. So,
okay, if there's no more questions for now, we're going to finish with our little quiz. So we've done it as the polling function in Zoom. So it's multiple choice, and you can just click this. Hang on a minute. I do need to go back to this. Oops. Hang on, sorry.
No.
Share my screen again for a minute. Because two of the questions are on the end. Okay. So I'm going to launch the poll. You don't have to fill it in if you don't want to, and it's just a bit of fun. Okay, so, but the last two questions relate to the two photographs that are on the screen now, so I hope you can see those.
So I'll let you read them out, Emily.
Yes, please, Alison, if you don't mind.
So what was the name of George Weller's home in Amersham on the Hill?
You have to click one of those given answers there.
Yeah. So was it the Plantation, Chardelot's or Weller House? Click any of those. Number two, how was the body of Joseph Brooks Weller returned home? Was it on a whaling boat, in a barrel of rum, or was he never returned? Do we scroll it down?
I can scroll it for you. Yeah, there we are.
Which company purchased the Weller Brewery and Tide Pubs in 1929? Was it Whitbread, Benskins, or the Aylesbury Brewery? And number four, whose cries saved the guests of the Crown Inn from a fire in 1935? A child's cries, a cockatoo's, or a dog's? And then the picture rounds that Emily showed you are just behind here. We've got the which pub is number five on the image, the Crown, the King's Arms, or the Elephant and Castle? And which pub is number six, the Swan, the Checkers, and the Booter Slipper? Obviously, this is quite hard for those of you that are in Australia or New Zealand.
Yes, sorry, I didn't realise that.
But anyone in Amersham has got no excuse.
Just while you're filling it in, I particularly wanted to use these photos because they also have a link with Australia, and they were sent to us a couple of years ago by a donor who found them in a collection of glass plates that he'd purchased, and he realised that lots of them, he worked out where they were from and what the connection was, and we think they were the photographs taken when the brewery and the Tide pubs were sold in 1929, because some of them actually there's almost like a before and after. So some of them have their Weller's signs up and some of them have their Benskin signs up, but in those cases there's one of each. So they're really fabulous photographs for the detail, you know, the sort of hanging baskets, and in some of them you can see the little net curtains at the window and what's inside, and they've really added to the collection. So if you're interested in a photograph of a particular pub or anything like that, then just get in contact with us and hopefully I can share that with you.
You can also see there the Weller's Entire, that was the most famous beer. That's branded on the pub on the right-hand side, number six.
And if anyone finds the recipe for it, please let us know and we'll try and get it brewed.
I don't know, actually. I haven't yet watched it. I don't know if it was featured, but I know there was a programme on a digital channel on Sunday about Amersham being Britain's most haunted town, and it featured... it should, probably have featured the pub on the right, which does have a ghost story associated with it.
Giving the game away, I know which one that is. I put the wrong one down and I've posted it off.
All right. It's quite a tricky one, I think.
Can I change it?
Yes.
I just saw someone ask about how many pubs Weller's owned at the time of the sale. I think, was it something like 147, Peter, do you remember?
142.
Yeah. That's right. Okay, nearly, not quite everyone's going. We'll just... if you're... can hear myself in. Maybe if you could mute yourselves if you're not, or if you put two screens on. Okay, we'll give you we'll have another few seconds more, and then Peter and Alison, between you, do you want to perhaps do one in turn and reveal the answers? And I'll tell you how many people got it right.
It'd be embarrassing if we get them right wrong, Peter, wouldn't it?
Just right, Rick.
Okay, the name of George Weller's home in Amersham on the Hill was the plantation.
Yes.
I think we've done a good job today because there's 100% correct answers on that one. So well done, everybody.
Peter?
I can't see the questions.
There we are. Can you see? Oh, you can't see them up. Sorry.
Shall I carry on then?
Yes, please.
Yeah. The body of Joseph Brooks Weller was returned in a barrel of rum.
Everybody got that right. So well done, everyone.
And the company which purchased the Weller Brewery was Ben Skins in 1929.
Also, virtually everybody got that right too, so well done.
And it was a cockatoo who saved the guests of the Crown Inn from a fire in 1935, and he is stuffed and at the Amersham Museum. It's one of our most cherished part of the collection.
Not in a barrel of rum, however.
No, but it is funny because when you recount that story, particularly if we have schools in and I recount that story to children, I say, you know, he's a hero for the town and he saved all the residents from a fire. They always say, well, why did you stuff him? Explain that was on his death rather than as a punishment.
So the picture round, the pubs, the first one, number five, is quite hard because, of course, it no longer looks like that at all. It's the King's Arms before it had its 1930s Tudor beef and makeover. And then number six is the Chequers, which pub is the Chequers. So down at the very end of Old Amersham.
Brilliant. Well done, everyone.
The thing that confused me for a while is that there should be a hill behind it. And I presume that the focus or something, or perhaps it was a bit of photoshopping, they took the hill away. So it looks as though it's on a flat.
You mean the photo of the Chequers? I double checked it, but we're fairly definite that's what it is.
Actually, I can ask a question because I think I know the answer here among the group. And why do people think it's haunted? I think Peter probably knows this one. I was going to ask everybody else.
Because it has a checkered history.
Oh, yeah, no. Go on, Peter, you give the answer.
Oh, well, because it showed it on television, so it must be anything.
Oh, I see. Okay. Okay.
Wasn't where the martyrs were supposed to be kept before they were taken to the stake and burned?
I think that's it.
Yes, yes. But there are allegedly two ghosts, one of who was one of the guards of the martyrs, maybe with a guilty conscience, and the other is a woman in white who was possibly the daughter of William Tarlesworth, who was forced to light the fire that burned her father. for the good of her soul, of course.
Well, I know once I went to a talk inside the pub there, and I remember the landlord was convinced that the dog was upset about this ghost. And he said he'd seen this ghost.
Well, that proves it, doesn't it?
Quite recently.
Maybe a theme for another session could be pub stories, because I interviewed a lady last year who was evacuated out of East London, and she was sent to the Chequers with her siblings. This sort of billeted there, really. And the second day that she was there, that she went across to Brazzles and got a job, there. So there's probably quite a lot in pub stories that we could do. I'm conscious of time, so we'll probably begin to wrap up now. I just want to say thank you very much to everyone who's joined us. I think we've had 50 people, which has been fabulous, and it's been really great to hear some of your comments. If there's anything that you would like to share with us, then please do. You know, kind of research is always ongoing. We're always trying to find out new things. There is further information about the George Weller I mentioned, as well as the Weller family, on the website. And Malcolm has posted in the chat the details of the Weller family website too. As I say, we are recording the session, so we will edit it and put it online for people to look at. But if you're interested in finding out more and anything else that we have in our collection about the Wellers, such as the photographs I've mentioned, we also have a copy of the sale catalogue when the brewery and the pubs were sold. Just get in touch with me. Final thing I wanted to mention really was topics for future sessions, if you'd like to join us again. One of the things that we have planned to talk about are, we've been doing quite a lot of research into emigre artists who moved to Amersham either temporarily or permanently, particularly around the time of the Second World War. And we've got some interesting research to present there. So we're certainly going to do that for another session. For those of you in the UK, you'll know that this is a census year for us. So for March, we thought we'd do something about the history of the census and census making. But if you've got any suggestions for something, an object in the collection or a research topic that you'd like us to do a session on, then just let us know. So thank you for joining us, and we hope to see you at another Local Stories again.